Hello everyone, Taki here. The Windows firmware for Odin is now publicly available, and it comes with some very important improvements. The developer behind this work has named the Windows release Project Valhalla, which you may recall was the code name for this handheld. In this video, we're going to take a look at the improvements to the playability of Steam games, as well as explore the performance of emulation under Windows with the Odin Pro. Let's start off with Steam. The biggest improvement that you will see is that we now have controller support on the device. In my last video where I showcased only PC games on the Odin Pro, none of the controls worked, so I had to use an external controller for filming. Obviously, this is not a great solution. The developer of this firmware had to fully create the input solution for these controls under Windows due to how they were created. We were originally only supposed to have non-analog buttons supported, but he managed to get both analog sticks and the analog L2 and R2 working. The controller firmware isn't perfect at this time, but it is good enough for use in this release. I'll talk more about the analog sticks when we get to the emulation section. As you can see, Steam's performance is pretty decent with these older PC titles. Now that this is publicly available, it'll be easier to crowdsource a complete list of games that run well on this device, because testing this can be very time consuming. What I want to see in this video is how decent emulation is under Windows. I started off these tests with RetroArch, and I decided to take a look at the performance of some systems that are supported by the platform. I will note that I'm using the 32-bit Windows build of RetroArch for this video, since there are no ARM builds on their website. This is going to cause some performance loss, as the ARM system has to run the application in a compatibility layer. For these older systems like CPS3, SNES, Genesis, and GBA, I didn't notice any big issues. When we move over to Dreamcast with the Flycast core, things get very interesting. Games will either not boot at all or crash on boot. In this case, the game crashes shortly after it's been booted. N64 is in the same situation, and I wasn't able to find a single emulator for either of these systems that could run on this device. There is a short list of emulators that have native ARM64 builds, and DuckStation is one of them. I had nearly identical performance using this version of the emulator compared to how it runs on Android. I have the games upscaled to 1080p, and I have PGXP turned on. Unfortunately, I ran into some issues with the analog sticks using this emulator. Due to the way the system pulls for analog input, there's a sizable amount of input delay when you use these sticks in Windows. I did not notice this as much with Steam games, but it's very noticeable in DuckStation. Thankfully, the D-pad works without issues, and it does not have latency issues. PPSSPP is another emulator that has a native ARM64 build, but this one does not perform as well as DuckStation. Some demanding games have no issues running at 4 or 5x native resolution, but other games that run fine under Android can't even run at 1x native resolution. I saw this problem in God of War, Ghosts of Sparta, and also in GTA, depending on where the camera was pointed. I don't have any idea if this performance could improve going forward, but for now, I would stick to Android for PSP emulation. GameCube is an interesting emulator to take a look at because the Dolphin team does not provide a link to an ARM64 build for their emulator. That being said, you do have the ability to build one for yourself, and one was provided to me for this video. If we're looking at the official build under Android versus the official build under Windows, I think the Windows build has better performance in general use and in some edge cases. The Windows build of Dolphin also has the benefit of being very easy to configure while you are running a game, and you'd really need to use something like MMJR2 under Android to have a comparable experience. I'll let the footage play out so you can judge the performance for yourself. In this final section, I want to go over the installation process of Project Valhalla. To install this firmware, you are going to need an Odin or an Odin Pro with a USB drive formatted as FAT32. I'll also point out that this will completely replace your Android firmware. You're going to start by going over to the GitHub page linked down below and head over to the Odin Releases repo. Once there, head over to Releases and you'll need to download the assets. Grab the two 7Z files and the boot image file that matches your Odin version. I've already gone ahead and downloaded all the files that I need, including the QPST folder that has our flashing application. Go inside the QPST folder and find the QFIL application inside the bin folder. Once this loads up, we have a few things that we need to do. First, we need to put the device into EDL mode. You can do this by holding down the volume up and volume down buttons at the same time while you connect a USB cable from your computer to Odin. If your system has drivers, the device should get automatically recognized. In my case, I needed to open up the Windows updater and grab the Qualcomm driver files that were listed under optional updates. After I did that, the system recognized my device. This process should be the same if you are on Windows 10. Once the device is connected, click on Browse and navigate to the firmware folder and select the Firehose file. Once that is done, click Load XML and load all of the files that you see and do the same thing again in the next window. After this, you can click on Download. If your download fails, make sure to go over to the Firehose configuration and change the device type to UFS. Now you will need to flash your bootloader. Hold down the power button for 10 seconds and your device will be in fast boot mode. You need the ADB drivers for this part, which are linked on GitHub. We are going to flash the boot partition with the file that we downloaded earlier, and then we are going to restart the device with fast boot reboot. The next part should be easier now that the file is being hosted. We need to get a specific file from the Windows installer to use with our USB files. Plug in your FAT32 USB drive into your computer and copy over the files inside the Odin Windows Installer folder. Make sure the install.wim file goes inside the images folder on your USB drive. Once you've finished all of that, you're almost done. Connect your USB drive to Odin and turn on the device. The new software that you just flashed should start the installation scripts on the USB drive once it boots. In my case, the system hung on the screen with no movement for a few moments. I did a hard reset and started it again without any issues. The install can take a while, so just leave the device alone while the install runs. When you get to the new user wizard, you should be fine after you make your way through all of the screens. In my case, the software would not let me progress, and I had to keep making accounts before it would finalize everything. Now that your device is booted into Windows 11, you'll have a few things that you'll want to do. First, I turned off auto rotate and changed my screen rotation from portrait to landscape. Inside the system properties window, I clicked on performance settings and selected adjust for best performance. I also went into advanced and then into virtual memory to change the paging file size. This is very important if you're using a 4GB Odin, as you will run out of RAM easily. If you're planning on using this for PC games, you'll also want to change the display resolution to the lowest value. This will ensure that you have the best performance possible. Since we are going to be using the on-screen keyboard, you will want to go into the touch keyboard settings and select the option to show the touch keyboard when there is no keyboard attached. It's also a good idea to remove some of the taskbar items so you can fill them with some of your most used applications. The home button on Odin will open up the start menu, so I have the taskbar set to auto hide to maximize my screen real estate. To monitor performance, I'm using the MSI Afterburner application with the FPS counter enabled. This won't work in all applications, but it should work for PC games. And that's about all there is to this new firmware. It goes without saying, but this will completely wipe your Android firmware from your device. You can put it back later if you want. If you are a mad lad with two Odins, it might be worth just leaving one on Windows and the other on Android. Right now, Android is the better platform for emulation, but this is pretty decent for older PC games. If you enjoyed this showcase, please leave a like, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.